maybe some people are starting their Super Bowl celebrations early, but you're here, so thank you for being here. I don't have any specific announcements. Does anyone have announcements today? In that case, let us prepare our hearts for worship.
Please rise in body or spirit to join in the call of worship. Happy are those who walk in the way of the Lord.
Happy are those who seek God with their whole hearts.
Let us worship God.
The good news is that in Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Friends, believe the good news.
In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Amen. There's a small tweak. We're going to have the choir first and then the kids.
Thank you.
imagine if we put a fifth bill on him? He fun to see. That was, wow, that was beautiful, that music just now, wasn't it? And Rachel's voice, we are so blessed to have her singing with her choir. You know, I've talked about this before, but I think it's worth repeating because it's so important. When we have beautiful music like that in worship, or any music, whether it's beautiful or not, when we have music in worship, it's a way of praying. And some people have said that when we sing in worship, we pray twice, because our words are our prayer, but also the music is our prayer. So when the choir or any soloists or anyone does music in worship, it's really a form of prayer to God, for God's glory and for our worship. And I'm just so grateful to have her here to do that. Because if we relied on my singing, I wouldn't be so pretty. I wanted to talk to you a little bit about something we're having in the gospel today, words of Jesus. And Jesus said a lot of really nice things, but also Jesus said some hard things. And today we're going to be hearing about some hard things. And one of the things that he said, Bennett, listen up, because this is going to mean something. It's going to be important. I'm going to be talking about brothers, and you have two brothers, so you might want to pay attention. So Jesus says in today's scripture, Jesus says, if you're on your way to church and you're going to give your offering to church, to God, you're going to worship God and give praise to God, but then you remember that your brother or sister or someone has a reason to be upset at you, and don't just leave your stuff there and then head back to your brother or sister or whoever has something against you. And ask for forgiveness and get forgiveness from that person. Because it's just important to have good relationships with each other as it is to have a good relationship with God. Emma, you're stuck with me alone. So a lot of times we think of God and our relationship with God as this one-way street between, you know, one dimension between me and God, and we forget that our relationships with other people are just important, just as important to God as our relationship with God. So we ask, and that's part of the reason we ask for forgiveness together in worship, is because it's not just about what I've done, it's also about what all of we have done together and making it right with God and one another. Well, thanks for sticking with me, Amen. Let's stand up and pray. Creator God, we are so grateful for the various ways to worship and for the gifts that people share for us to worship. God, we pray that we would be mindful of the ways that we have harmed other people or wronged other people so that we would ask for forgiveness and be right with them in order to be right with you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. My friends, you are God's beloved child. With you, God is well pleased. Thanks for that.
Descendants may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying him,
means life to you and length of days, so that you may live in the land the Lord swore to give to your ancestors, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. Blessings be with you.
Paul writes, brothers and sisters. I could not speak to you as spiritual people, but rather as people of the flesh, as infants in Christ. I fed you with milk, not solid food, for you are not ready for solid food. Even now you are still not ready, for you are still of the flesh. For as long as there is jealousy and quarreling among you, are you not of the flesh and behaving according to human inclinations? For when one says, I belong to Paul, and another, I belong to Apollos, are you not merely human? What then is Apollos? What is Paul? Servants through whom you came to believe as the Lord assigned to each. I planted Apollos watered, but God gave the growth. So neither the one who plants nor the one who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth. The one who plants and the one who waters have a common purpose, and each will receive wages according to the labor of each. For we are God's servants working together. You are God's field, God's building. Friends, this is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Loving God, anoint us with your Holy Spirit as we hear your word this day. Fill us with your truth that we may walk in the ways of God and to the glory of your realm. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Jesus' words in the gospel lesson today are difficult. And while my sermon today is focused on the epistle, on Paul's letter to the Corinthians, I wanted to share with you how Eugene Peterson concludes that section in his paraphrase, The Message. Peterson writes, Jesus says, in a word, what I'm saying is grow up. Your kingdom subjects, now live like it. Live out your God-created identity. Live generously and graciously towards others, the way God lives towards you. And that fits in, right in, with what Paul is saying to the Corinthians. Essentially, Paul is saying, grow up, your kingdom subjects. Now live like it. Live out your God-created identity. Live generously and graciously towards others, the way God lives toward you. And switching to our epistle passage, which begins today with Paul writing, brothers and sisters, I could not speak to you as spiritual people, but rather as people of the flesh, as infants in Christ. The scripture begins with Paul setting up this dichotomy between spiritual people and people of the flesh, who are infants in Christ. And when I hear Paul's phrase, infants in Christ, of course, I can't help but think of the actual infants and children we have in our church family. We are so blessed to have several children in our church family, and more every year. We literally have children, infants in Christ. We literally have baby Christians. We have a lot to teach them, just as the Israelites were being taught by God in our first scripture reading this morning, just as Jesus was teaching his followers in the gospel reading, and just as Paul teaches the Corinthians in this letter. We have a lot to teach them, and for those who were baptized in this church, we took vows to do just that, to help their parents and their families and the Sunday school teachers, to help them all raise these children to be faithful Christians. So what will we teach them? Now I have to have a little sidebar here. I want to take a moment to push back a little against Paul, against this binary thinking of spiritual versus flesh, and especially this idea that being spiritual is something we grow into, something that needs to be taught and learned, something that needs to be fed to us. On the contrary, children are born spiritual beings. Babies are born with spirituality. Our job as a church family, as godparents to all the children in our care, is to help them retain that spirituality, because society won't help them do that. Help them to develop it further throughout their lives. Our job is to help them discover and grow in God, and at the same time, to recognize that they have much to teach us. Our job is to learn from them as much as the other way around. But back to Paul's letter, Paul continues, I fed you with milk, not solid food, for you were not ready for solid food. Even now you are still not ready, he says. So apparently Paul taught the Corinthians some kind of Christianity light, because in his mind they were not ready for the full story. And I wonder just what Paul means here. I wonder what the milk of Christian teaching is, as opposed to the solid food. Granted, I have my ideas of what lighter Christianity teaching might be, as opposed to the more difficult teachings that we are challenged with. And I suppose that we still do that, don't we? After all, I'm preaching on this and not the gospel lesson for today. We prefer to think about, to hear about, to learn about the soft and warm and fuzzy side of Christianity. Love, grace, and forgiveness. They're all wonderful things. And most of us prefer to leave the more difficult parts for another time. Let's not talk about suffering, service, and sacrifice. We're not ready. That's not nice. It's not fun. Doesn't make me feel better. And I think that's what Paul was doing with the Corinthians. He was teaching them the easier parts to digest. But apparently, according to Paul, the Corinthians weren't even ready for that. He tells them, you are still of the flesh. As long as there is jealousy and quarreling among you, are you not of the flesh, behaving according to human inclination? Paul calls the Corinthians out for being of the flesh, as evidenced by their jealousy, their quarrels, their behaving according to human inclinations. Ouch. If it's a requirement for being a Christian to never quarrel or be jealous or behave according to human inclinations, I think we're all in trouble. And I'd best be looking for another career. If that's the case, I suspect there are very few among us, or indeed throughout history, who would make the cut according to this dynamic, including, I suspect, Paul himself. If that's the case, it's probably true that the last real Christian died on the cross. But what are these quarrels about? This is where we start to find out. According to Paul, they're fighting about, I belong to Paul, and someone else says, I belong to Apollos. Paul says, are you not merely human? Paul gets to the crux of the problem, and the problem is that he has with his baby Christians in Corinth is that they're bickering with each other over who follows Paul's teachings and who follows Apollos. Another teacher, Apollos is this other teacher who apparently came to Corinth after Paul. And some Corinthians are saying, I belong to Paul, while others declare, I belong to Apollos. And they seem to be forgetting, or perhaps they were never aware in the first place, that they all belong to Christ. They do not belong to either Paul or Apollos. Does this sound familiar? Paul asks, what then is Apollos? What is Paul? Servants through whom you came to believe as the Lord assigned to each. Paul has to remind the Corinthians that Apollos and Paul himself are mere servants of God. They are not to be argued over and followed as if they themselves were the deities to be worshipped. Apollos and Paul are mere servants sent by God. And this reminder serves us well in these 2,000 years later. Whether you're a Presbyterian or a Lutheran, Roman Catholic, or UCC, Baptist, or non-denominational, or if you identify identify with another denomination or tradition, at the end of the day, we are Christian, and it is the same Christ we follow, the same Christ we are called to serve. And Paul continues, I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the growth. So neither the one who plants nor the one who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth. The one who plants and the one who waters have a common purpose, and each will receive wages according to the labor of each. And here Paul brings in this beautiful metaphor of growth. He says that he planted, that is, he planted the church, bringing Christianity to Corinth. That Apollos watered, that is, he nurtured and continued the work after Paul left. But, and this is a big but, God gave the growth. God gave the growth. As we take responsibility for nurturing the children in our midst in the ways of Christ, we take a huge responsibility to water and nurture and attend to their spirits. But we are reminded that it is God who gives the growth. Paul reminds the Corinthians that neither he, the one who planted, nor Apollos, the one who watered, are anything. It is only God who gives growth, only God who is to be followed, obeyed, and worshipped. It's not about racking up a bunch of followers. It's not about numbers, whether people in the pews or names on the membership rolls or dollars in the offering plate. We're not competing with the church across the street or the church next door or the church behind us or the church next to the church behind us or the church across town or the church in the movie theater. We're not competing with any of them or anyone else because we have a common purpose to serve God and to follow Christ, to nurture children and adults to do the same. Our passage concludes, for we are God's servants, working together. You are God's field, God's building. And here it is. We are God's servants, working together. We are God's servants, working together. You are God's fields, God's building. I just love that. You are God's field, God's building. Every baby, every child, every adult baptized at this font or any other font for that matter is God's field. Every one of you, all of us, God's fields. And we are called to work together to nurture one another in Christ. And it makes me wonder, makes me think about what this really means to be God's servants. To truly be God's servants, what does it mean to be God's servants working together? What does it mean to be God's field, to be God's building? This beautiful structure in which we stand and are blessed to have as a place of worship, this is not God's building. We are God's building. We are God's building. We are nearing now the season of Lent, this season when Christians have traditionally given up something as a form of a spiritual discipline. As some of you might recall, I'm a big fan of spiritual disciplines. I'm especially a fan of giving things up for Lent. The more difficult the challenge, the better. I remember someone in my last church, one year I became vegan, and then the next year I gave up something else. Like, I kept giving up more and more stuff, and they were like, by next Lent, you're just going to be drinking water. I love to give stuff up for Lent. In the spirit of being God's servant, I'm wondering what I might do that's not giving something up for Lent. Because to be honest, it's gotten to the point where I keep adding stuff on to give up or to take on. And it's so much stuff that I actually lose track of everything I'm supposedly doing for Lent. That doesn't seem like it's particularly useful. So in the spirit of being God's servant, what act of service might I take on that's brand new to me? I wonder what it would look like if we each found something, an act of service brand new to us, to take on this Lent. And you don't have to do it alone either, because remember the second part, God's servants working together. Maybe you find a friend or two and decide to take on a project together. Maybe. Ash Wednesday is still a week and a half away, so you have some time to think about what your act of service will be, but I challenge you to think of something. It may be something very small you can do every day, like pick up a piece of trash every day off the street. Or maybe you have a friend who's lonely, who you can check in with just a little more frequently than you normally do. Or maybe invite that friend over to coffee or lunch. Maybe it's something a little bigger that you do once or twice during Lent. Maybe spend a day volunteering somewhere. But I invite you, and me, all of us, I invite us to put some thought into what that might be. Don't do something you're already doing. Do something new. And I will be following up, so be prepared, because I'm going to be following up with you. Beloved in Christ, the good news is we are God's servants working together. You are God's field, God's building. Your kingdom subjects, now act like it. Live out your God-created identity, live generously and graciously toward others, the way God lives toward you. Amen.
Because you gave, our church family in Newton is able to share from our abundance and support our church family as close as here in Newton and as far away as South Sudan. The beauty of our Connectional Presbyterian branch of the body of Christ is that your support of this church helps to support the ministry of the Presbytery of Des Moines and the ministry of our church nationally and internationally. Thank you for your support of our shared ministry. Jesus said, if you remember that a brother or sister has something against you, first be reconciled to them, and then come and offer your gift. In peace, let us bring our offerings to God. The morning offering will now be taken.
Thank you.
so that together we may plant and water the seeds of your new world. May we be your faithful servants as we cultivate your love, knowing that in all we accomplish, it is you who gives the growth. Amen.
We come to a time in our worship together when we share our prayers of joy and concern, as is the custom in this congregation. If you have a prayer request, raise your hand. I see Terry's ready to bring the mic around to you. After you've stated your prayer request, I will say either God in your mercy or God in your grace, and I invite you all to join me in lifting it to God by saying, hear our prayer. Are there any particular prayer requests this morning? Linda.
At various times over the past 5 years, I've talked with people about a young woman who I was sponsored or serving as liaison on the Committee on Preparation for Ministry, who went through cancer, who went through shingles, who went through a bone marrow transplant. Yesterday at Presbytery, she was certified, prepared to seek a call and come ordained. She's going to be a huge blessing to our denomination and to our world. Thanks be to God.
And she wrote a beautiful statement of faith, and she presented herself beautifully. We are very blessed to have her in service to God through our presbytery. God in your grace.
Yeah.
Are there other prayer requests this morning? Got a laundry list. Go ahead, Terry.
Just a quick joy for having to have Jeanette's son, Kathy's brother, and my brother-in-law, Pat Shannon, visiting from Omaha.
Welcome, Pat. God in your grace.
Hear our prayers.
Of course, I begin with prayers for the victims in the earthquake in Turkey and Syria. This morning I wrote down 28,000 dead, and then immediately after that I heard that it's been, the estimate is now 30,000 dead. And from what it sounds like, they might be the lucky ones, because it's a very, very bad situation. In Syria especially, because as we know, they are still in a state of civil war in Syria. So we pray for Turkey and for Syria, and there is, hopefully next week I'll have more information for you, but there you can give through Presbyterian Disaster Assistance, and also I just encourage you, if you give through some other means, to make sure that it's a reputable charity that will get your money where it needs to go. But we pray for the victims and those who are assisting them. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
A little closer to home, we pray for Chris Simbro, who has spent a night in the hospital with symptoms that they weren't able to actually figure out what's wrong with him, but he seems to be getting better and he is home now. So we pray for his continued recovery as well as for Sandy. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
We also continue to hold Gary and Kate Parsons in prayer. From the last I heard from Kate yesterday, it seems like there's a little glimmer of hope there, but Gary has had a really, really hard time of it. He went from lighting candles here on Christmas Eve to the hospital on two days later, and has just continued to decline. But it sounds like he's making some progress, and we hope that that will be continued. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Prayers as well for Mary Moskilly, who is now on hospice and probably does not have much time left. So we pray for her and for Rod, who is doing a great job of caring for her. And I'll keep you updated as that situation changes. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
As Linda alluded to, yesterday we had a Presbytery meeting, and There's some interesting things going on in Presbytery. I'll just say that everyone wants to be servants of God, working together, and there's just a breadth of ways that people feel like we do that. And of course, that brings the quarreling and the jealousy and the whatever else it was that Paul said was happening among humans. So we pray for our entire presbytery, and that we may find ways to be the best possible instruments of peace for God in the world. God, in your mercy, hear our prayers. As we do from time to time, pray for individual churches and leaders in the presbytery. This week we pray for First Presbyterian Church of Brooklyn, and their person serving them right now is Linda Whitmarsh Peterson. God, in your mercy, hear our prayers. And finally, we pray for peace throughout the world, particularly in South Sudan and Ukraine, and we pray for our divided country and our broken world. God, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Let us continue in prayer. We pray for the health and vitality of the church. God, you command us to honor you by loving one another. Yet all too often there is quarreling and jealousy among us. Help us to live your law of love as we seek to grow into the full stature of Christ. Loving God, help us to turn our hearts toward you. We pray for the welfare of the world. You have blessed us with every skill and gift for nurturing the common good. Yet our self-centered ways incline our hearts toward evil. Strengthen us to work together for the mutual benefit of neighbors near and far, and for the life and prosperity of your reign on earth. Loving God, help us to turn our hearts toward you. We pray for the well-being of your creation. Our choices wreak havoc on the world you have made and put your planet in peril. Guide our patterns of consumption for the flourishing of all creation and for generations yet unborn. Loving God, help us to turn our hearts toward you. We pray for all who suffer and are in need. You call us to care for one another with compassion and steadfast love. Yet we wither in the face of anguish and brokenness. Equip us for the work of reconciliation, that we might offer hope and healing in the power of your name. Loving God, help us to turn our hearts toward you. We pray for all who are sick and are dying. May your will for them be fulfilled. Fill us with your mercy and kindness, that we may care for them with loving hearts as you bring them to the fullness of your peace. Loving God, help us to turn our hearts toward you. We commend all of life to you, O God, knowing that you hear our prayers and answer them according to your will. Through Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Please rise in body or in spirit to sing our closing hymn, number 382, Somebody's Knocking at Your Door.
Thank you.
walk humbly now. You are not obligated to complete the work, but neither are you free to abandon it. Life is short, and we do not have much time to gladden the hearts of those who travel away with us. So be quick to love, make haste to be kind, and the blessing of God, the Creator, the Christ, and the Holy Spirit be among you now and always.